Growing in a greenhouse allows one to maximize space and increase yield. In order for the plants to thrive, several considerations and decisions must be made. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and this video surveys general practices used in producing crops in the greenhouse. To promote maximum crop growth and development, an optimal greenhouse environment must be maintained. Environmental factors that must be carefully controlled are temperature, light, including light quality, intensity, and duration, air, humidity, and water. Environmental controls for heating and cooling can be very simple, such as using a basic thermostat, or they can be as complex as using a computer. In general, the night temperatures in the greenhouse should be kept between 55 and 65 degrees Fahrenheit, with the day temperature being 10 to 15 degrees Fahrenheit warmer. In addition to optimizing shoot temperatures in the greenhouse, it is important to optimize the root zone temperature. Supplying supplemental bottom heat reduces the need for higher above ground temperatures in the greenhouse, thereby conserving energy. When deciding what form of supplemental lighting to use, the light quality, intensity, and duration required by the crops that will be grown must be considered. Maximum light intensity in greenhouses can be achieved in several ways. First, use greenhouse coverings that allow maximum light transmission. Supplemental lighting in greenhouses is commonly used to maximize growth. The most common form of supplemental lighting used in greenhouses is high-intensity discharge lamps, HID, because they provide maximum light intensity and light quality. Although currently pricey, many growers are moving to LED lighting, which reduces operational expenses. High light intensity promotes shorter plants, whereas a lower light intensity promotes taller plants. Light duration involves the length of exposure to light in a 24-hour period. To stimulate the outdoor environment, plants are exposed to different day-night regimes. Greenhouses will use supplemental lighting and blackout screens to manipulate short day and long day plants. In addition to maintaining the proper temperature and light levels, the atmospheric composition of the greenhouse must also be controlled. In a well-ventilated greenhouse, the addition of supplemental carbon dioxide is typically unnecessary. However, during the heating season when greenhouse vents are typically kept closed, carbon dioxide levels may become limiting, which makes it important to add supplemental carbon dioxide. Sufficient light must also be available when supplemental carbon dioxide is being added. Another problem that can occur in a greenhouse during the winter months is the buildup of unwanted gases. This problem can be overcome by properly servicing the heating system to make sure it runs at peak efficiency, and in some instances, using air purification units. Maintaining the proper relative humidity is also important in a greenhouse environment. If relative humidity is too low, the plants become stressed. If it is too high, plants are susceptible to leaf and flower diseases. Humidifying a greenhouse can be accomplished using commercial humidifier units. However, when this is not possible, good watering procedures can lessen problems associated with low humidity. Successful greenhouses also require good quality water with low levels of contaminants such as salt, chlorine, fluoride, or others to minimize problems when growing plants. In addition to optimal environmental conditions in the greenhouse, it is important to select a container that will promote maximum growth. Both advantages and disadvantages are associated with the different types of available containers. The three main materials used to produce pots are clay, plastic, and styrofoam. In the past, clay was the most popular. Clay pots are porous, which enables water to evaporate from the pot to avoid waterlogging. Clay pots are also heavier, stronger, and can support large plants without falling over. The main disadvantage is that clay pots are more expensive than plastic pots. Plastic pots are the most commonly used today because they are inexpensive and come in a variety of sizes and shapes. They are non-porous, so waterlogging can be a problem. Styrofoam containers have become popular because they insulate well to keep the soil warm, and they are lightweight and come in a variety of sizes and shapes. Two disadvantages are that they break easily and are difficult to clean. Today, the grower has many choices in containers and must carefully weigh the advantages and disadvantages to decide what will work best in a particular situation. A variety of containers are available for different uses, which can be broken down into the following three groups: rooting containers, bedding plant containers, and green and flowering plant containers. Rooting containers come in organic and inorganic forms. Organic forms include peat pellets, peat plugs, and peat pots. The dry compressed peat pellet is flat, saving space during storage. Upon hydration, it expands and is ready for seeding or sticking a cutting. The seedling can be transplanted directly without removing it from the moss medium. Inorganic forms are made of plastic foam and are compressed plastic or inert inorganic materials in the form of a cube or block similar to peat plugs. Bedding plants are generally grown in bedding plant containers or cell packs, which can vary in size but typically come in sets of 2, 4, 6, or more cells. The main advantage of bedding plant containers is that they lend themselves to mechanization. However, the main disadvantage is that the cells are typically small and plants may become root-bound if left too long, which may lead to transplant shock. Most green and flowering plants are grown in plastic containers because they are less expensive. There are four different types of pots commonly used. Standard size pots are equal in width and height and better for shorter plants. Azalea pots are slightly shorter, making them more stable. Bulb pans are half as high as they are wide and used for propagating plants or for plants that grow from bulbs. And then there are hanging baskets. Growing media used for potting plants is commonly used to accommodate specific needs, such as mixes used solely for promoting germination. Although differences exist in the types of growing media on the market, all mixtures should be reproducible, available, and have basic physical, chemical, and biological properties. Some important functions that all growing media should include are good moisture and nutrient holding capacity, physical properties that permit rapid water infiltration, aeration, and drainage. A good growing medium should contain materials that do not rapidly decompose, flow easily to facilitate rapid pot filling, and be free of toxins. In addition, growing media should provide support for the plant and have good cation exchange capacity, CEC, and a pH in the range between 5.5 and 6.0, or according to the needs of the specific plant being grown. A good growing media has both organic and inorganic components. Some key components in growing media are peat moss, wood byproducts, bark, and vermiculite, which are used because of their high moisture and nutrient holding capacity, while sand and perlite are used to promote good aeration and drainage. Selecting the proper materials for the preparation of growing media maximizes plant growth and development. Factors that should be taken into consideration are the quality of the ingredients, reproducibility and availability, cost, use, and ease of preparation. Watering plants is a major responsibility because most horticultural crops are between 90 to 98% water. Both underwatering and overwatering can adversely affect the quality of a crop. Overwatering is the most common problem, which leads to oxygen deprivation in the root zone and ends in root rot. Important considerations for watering plants include timing, amount to apply, and watering carefully. Water should be applied before the plant shows signs of wilting, which indicates stress resulting in premature senescence and reduced crop yields. The proper time to water can be determined by simply feeling the weight of the pot, feeling the soil, using indicator plants, or using tensiometers, which are instruments used to measure the amount of water in a given pot. Thoroughly water each time plants are irrigated, but do not overwater. About 10% of the water applied to a pot should drain out of the bottom, which ensures that the soil is thoroughly wet and helps flush out excessive salts that may have accumulated in the pot. To prevent disease, apply water to the growing medium and not to the foliage or flowers. Plants can be watered in many ways, so it is important to choose one that works best for the particular purpose of the greenhouse. Seven types of irrigation systems are commonly used in greenhouses. The oldest type is manually watering with a hose. Automated systems have been developed that differ in cost, efficiency, and flexibility. The tube irrigation system is the most commonly used method for watering potted plants. Two commonly used tube irrigation systems are the Chapin system and Stuppy system. The only major difference between the two systems is the weight at the end of each tube. For the Chapin system, a lead weight is at the end of the tube, whereas for the Stuppy system, the weight is plastic. One of the advantages of this method is that water is applied directly to the soil without splashing plants with a soil-water mixture every time the plants are watered, thereby reducing the spread of diseases. Another advantage of this system is that individual pots can be watered automatically at the correct amounts and at the right frequency, thereby maximizing plant growth and development. Tube irrigation also enables the grower to apply water-soluble chemicals such as fertilizers and pesticides. The disadvantages are that it is expensive to install and is not flexible. In addition, pots on the bench have to be uniform in size and the tube must be inspected on a periodic basis to make sure no blockage exists as a result of salt buildup. The capillary mat system is a type of sub-irrigation where pots are placed on a mat saturated with water that is taken up by the growing medium via wick action through holes in the bottom of the pot. For the system to work properly, the mat must be placed on a level surface. The capillary mat system is flexible and easy to install, can readily accommodate different pot sizes, and plants can be rearranged as required throughout their life cycle. One disadvantage of this system is the potential for algae growth, which causes a number of other problems. The ebb and flow method is a form of sub-irrigation that pumps water into a watertight bench at regular intervals, filling the benches with water and enabling the growing medium to take up water via wick action through holes in the bottom of the pot. It is more expensive than the capillary mat system. In overhead irrigation systems, water is applied over the canopy of plants using spray nozzles. This method is commonly used on bedding plants. The problem with this method is that wet foliage increases the chances of disease. Therefore, watering should be done in the morning to give the plant foliage enough time during the day to dry. Perimeter irrigation is a surface form of watering. Pipes are placed around the perimeter of the flower bed with nozzles located below the foliage, and they deliver a flat spray of water over the growing medium, ensuring that cut flowers and foliage do not get wet. The soaker hose method for watering plants is a surface form of irrigation commonly used on flower beds. This method uses a series of hoses that are placed on the surface of the flower bed, and water oozes or drips out of the line. Plants grown in a greenhouse are generally grown in restrictive pots, with less growing media than when plants are grown in the field. Plants grown in the greenhouse typically use soilless growing medium, which requires fertilization, especially with micronutrients. The two types of fertilizers that can be used are organic and inorganic. Organic fertilizers are typically used by specialty growers and are not used in greenhouses for a variety of reasons. For example, organic fertilizers cannot be easily adapted to automated watering systems, and applying the exact amounts of nutrient elements is difficult. Organic fertilizers also produce volatiles that have bad odors, making their use in enclosed conditions unpleasant, and these volatiles can also have adverse effects on plant growth. Inorganic fertilizers are synthetic nutrient compounds that are derived from mineral salts. They are convenient to apply using a variety of application methods. Another benefit is that they can be applied in exact amounts as needed. Both dry and liquid fertilizers can be used in greenhouses. However, liquid forms are most commonly used because they can be applied through the irrigation system and are immediately available. Dry formulations come as fast release and slow release. Fast release, as the name implies, is available immediately and can be used to take care of a deficiency problem. Slow release fertilizers are commonly used in greenhouses because they are released over a long period of time. Media and foliar testing should be done to avoid deficiency problems in greenhouse crops. It is important because as soon as visual symptoms are observed, the plant is being stressed, which reduces quality and yields. All the necessary precautions must be taken to prevent pests from entering the greenhouse. Many practices are often used in greenhouses that would be very difficult under field conditions. One way to prevent pests from entering greenhouses is by putting screens on vents and taking precautions to minimize pests from entering on the shoes or clothes of workers. Another way is to practice weed control outside the greenhouse, thereby minimizing their entry. Sanitation coupled with crop inspection is also effective for minimizing disease incidents in greenhouses. If possible, growers can manipulate the environment to adjust conditions so that they are not favorable for the pests. This is cultural control. If pests enter the greenhouse, biological control works well unless the population of pests gets too high, in which case a combination of chemical, genetic, cultural, and mechanical control should be used. Biological control is the use of predators and parasites to control the pests. In conclusion, you now understand how growing crops in the greenhouse has become more technical and specialized as a result of increased consumer demands for quantity and quality crops. Many aspects go into it, from choosing the right pot to the proper media, irrigation, fertilizer, and pest control.